So, namaskar everyone. Why I said namaskar is that namaskar is basically our Indian culture, and being a beauty queen, whenever I've traveled the world, I've carried that Indian, what you can say is tradition, and that's what they loved about me, that I was the one who always taught, you know, people how we live in India, how we welcome our guests. A lot of people ask me this question, you know, you are so fat and you are so big, how did you win 3 times the same contest? I said it was only because I was confident. It was only because I was not there to win the crown. I was there to win the hearts of people. And when you win the hearts of people, you can win anything in your life, okay? So, today I'm gonna tell you a story about a girl, a rainbow girl in fact, to be called as. When she was born in Delhi, in a very, very rich family, there was a huge celebration of her being born. And there were ministers who were present in her, you know, what you call that celebration. And then there were like a lot of people from the all the rich community from Delhi. So everybody celebrated her coming. But when she started becoming, you know, you can say younger, not older, she's becoming younger, she started developing some kind of colors on her faces, okay? Which started becoming a shame for her family. When she was 7 years old, her entire face was not of one color, it was of 7 colors. Violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, and red. So, people normally don't see such color on somebody's face. For some people, like say it's an art, for some people, she was very, very attractive. For some people, she was a shame. For her own siblings, she became a shame. When she used to go to school, able to say, hey, rainbow colors, brother, hey, rainbow color sister. This to come back home, tell her parents that we are very ashamed of her. Can't we throw her somewhere? Can't we kill her? And that girl loved her parents like any one of you would love. So the parent decided one day to throw her out of the house. She cried a lot, and she requested, she pleaded that please don't throw me out of the house. I will stay the way you want me to stay. I will not go to school. I will sit at home, but don't throw me out. But the parents didn't listen. They were more bothered about that high class, you know, image in the society. So they just asked her to leave the house. This little girl, 7-year-old girl, goes to Mumbai. She goes to Mumbai and goes to her uncle, a paternal uncle who was very, very poor. And he already had about 8 kids and was staying in a chawl. And she met a stepmom out there, a stepmom who would ask her to do everything, to clean the house, to take care of her, the siblings out there, to do everything, and she was not allowed to study. One day she came with the terms with her family, the extended family, you can say that, that she wants to study. They said, we don't have money for your studies. She said, I'll manage. She said, how are you going to manage? She said that whatever work I'm doing here, I'll do it outside and I'll get paid for it. That little girl goes to a dhaba nearby and asks for work. Because she was attractive to look at, the owner immediately gave her the work. She went to school in the mornings. In the afternoon, she used to come back. She used to clean the entire dhaba, go in the night to the home, clean everything at home as well, utensils and everything. And then she used to study. This continued when she turned 11. When she turned 11, she was quite tall, and she was molested and raped by her own brother, by her cousin brother. And not just he raped her, there were among with him 5 more gentlemen. Who raped her. She was 11, and the rapists were 24 years, 25 years, 28 years, like that age. We cried so much that there was a rape case somewhere, and it was highlighted in the media. But do you know, every day, this kind of molestation that happened behind the closed doors, what do we do about them? They go unreported. the family says to them, please don't talk about it, because it will bring shame to the society. It will bring shame to the family. And that's what happened to her. She cried again. She cried to Lord Krishna. She said, why have you given birth to me? For all this? Then she met another rainbow girl while she was getting treated for her rape in the hospital, who told her that, look, hey, you know that's a rainbow girl. There are many rainbow girls like you. Why don't you come along with me? She said, no, I don't want to come along with you because the kind of work you people do, like, you know, you go for begging and clapping, I don't want to do that. She said, okay, fine, I'll get you a job where you can stay, you can have food, you can have everything. And she got her second job at a very nice place that you people always hate to even describe that place. It's called Dance Bar. She landed at the age of 11 when she had to be in the school in a dance bar. All she was doing was entertaining the people who used to come there in the evening. She used to dance in front of them. She used to get paid. And she used to get indecent proposals, which she always said no. At the age of 18, she met her cousin sister. Her name was Viveka Babaji, who was Miss Mauritius World 1993 and Miss Mauritius Universe 1994. She was the one who inspired her to go to fashion. And this girl, I mean Viveka Babaji, she told her that she's going to sponsor her entire education. This girl, Rainbow Girls, she goes to the college, she appears for the exam, entrance exam, she clears it, she goes for the interview, she clears that as well. Not only that, her 3 years of education, she topped in all the semesters. And then comes the final show, where the students have to showcase their collection, and she gets Best Designer Award. After this is done, she gets campus placement. She gets campus placement with big designers like Ritu Kumar. And after that, she worked at Duberry. The only problem that she was facing was discrimination because of color. Because everyone in the that place, in that workplace, used to make fun of her. Used to say, hey, you are different. Hey, you are this. At the same time, those people who were making fun of her in the daytime used to tell her in the night, can you come to our place? They were offering her money, which she denied. She continued this work for almost 4 to 5 years, but she couldn't sustain herself because her creativity was being murdered by those men and that society who was not letting her live for what she wanted to live for. Then, when she said, this is what I have to do, she landed up doing sex work. She landed up in the red light areas. She landed up in all the places where you'll find the call girls to be. She became one of the highest paid call girls in New Delhi. And after that, her life was taking a turn. She met a photographer, a very big photographer, who wanted to shoot her and who wanted to follow her everywhere. She asked him, why you are doing this? He said that I want to show the pain of how rainbow girls are there in the country. I want to show in my pictures. He made a black and white series, a biopic of that girl's life. For 1 year, that man followed her when she was bathing, nude, when she was making out with a client with hidden cameras. He followed her when she was standing on a red light area. He followed her when she was going for worship because she was a firm believer of Lord Krishna. He followed her everywhere for two winters. And the miracle happened when those pictures were, you know, showcased in an exhibition in Milan. There was the editor of Tehelka magazine who was right there. He saw the girl. He said that Recently, in 2015, there were two trans celebrities of the West in America. One was Lavanya Cox, one is Caitlyn Jenner. They had appeared in the magazine of, this one, Time magazine, and the Vanity Fair, you know. So they appeared there, and they said, why can't we have in India a trans girl on the cover of a magazine? So he said that, I want this girl. Who is this girl? So he contacted that girl, and she became India's first ever trans model. And she became India's first ever trans girl model who was painted and who was made to dress up really nicely. And that was the first ever time this thing came in. And that rainbow girl was no other than me. I was that rainbow girl. So here, the success story doesn't start. In fact, this roller coaster ride of emotions and a roller coaster ride of all those worst nightmares were yet to begin. She became the first trans girl model. She became the first trans model ever. But people were hesitant of giving her work. They said, when we have girl model, why do we need a trans woman, you know, out here? And there were like a lot of people who made fun of her, the fellow models. But she continued. She said, I've seen the worst, let it come. So she started modeling. She applied for Miss World Diversity in 2017 through online. She was selected. This pageant was only for women that time. But when she sent pictures, her director, the owner of this pageant, didn't know that she was a trans woman. She thought that she's a normal woman. And she asked her to come to South Africa for the first competition ever. So I went to South Africa, and she asked me, are you trans? I said, yes, I'm trans. She said that, you know, our rule book says that you cannot participate. I said that I have come, give me a chance, you know, if you think that I'm not performing, eliminate me anytime, I don't mind. So the competition started. We had these small little babies who had come with HIV, positive, they were living with HIV, and we were given a task to be with them for 24 hours. There were like a lot of contestants from other countries who were hesitant to be with them, but I embraced them because I had also something called mamta in me, which I wanted to be a mother, and I embraced them. I was the one who gave them a lot of love. They used to come and sleep with me because they didn't have their mothers to be with them because the mothers died of HIV. So I gave them so much love, they became my family, and that's what touched the hearts of the organizers. Then I came back home. After 7 days, I was crowned. We had an Indian girl who was crowned as Miss World. So no one wrote about me, everybody wrote about her, you know. And our media also, they were so biased. They said, it's a promotional story, because I wrote to them and I said that this is what I have achieved. Sorry, this is a promotional story. So what about the other girl? That's not a promotional story. If she's won Miss World competition, and I, from the community itself, for the first time ever I got a crown for India, am I not supposed to be written? Anyways, that story went back. Then I went to the Miss World Diversity competition in 2018. In 2018, I went for a hope that maybe my country media will wake up and write about it. See, it was not about me. It was also about other trans women in the country who thought that, you know, we don't have any option apart from begging, clapping, or prostitution. I wanted to give them an example that, hey, if I can do it, so can you. Again, I came back. Few media wrote about me, but that was not enough. I again back in 2019 to Mauritius. This time it was in Mauritius. And I was asked by my judges, why do you come again and again? I said, this crown that I'm wearing, it gives me power. It gives me power to voice out my opinions. It gives me power to talk about, you know, my community and my people. And it's not about my people. Also, it's about, you know, India as a whole. I'm not representing only trans community here. I'm representing the entire India. So then they decided, yes, the crown should be given back to India. But my question to you is that, why are we discriminating? Why is it that when a woman wins an international crown, she's been called by our prime minister, he honors her. When the woman from a trans community comes and wins the crown for the first time, she's not even called. In spite of writing her 100 letters to him, he doesn't even reply. Our government is very, very transphobic. On the paper, it's written that we are only 4 lakh population, but in real, we are more than 5 million of us, trans men and trans women. Why are we not heard? I feel so fortunate to be on this stage and talking to all of you that only because we look different, we don't fit into the image of so-called women, we have to go tomorrow and we have to prove to our district magistrate that we are transgenders. Why? You know, why this kind of a behavior in our country? You all are independent from 1947. When did we get independence? Just 1 year ago, in 2018, when they decriminalized 377. That the first time we felt safe in the country. Why we took so long? When Britishers made this rule in their own country, they scrapped off so early. And in India, it was still existing. Why we had to come out of our homes, do the parade marches, and to ask for our rights? We are talking about women empowerment. We're talking about gender equality. Why can't we talk about trans people as well? When somebody said that, of course there should be a dialogue, there should be discussion. But so many people, they just don't want to discuss about it. They don't want to talk about the trans people at all. For them, trans people means begging, clapping, prostitution. That's about it. They don't think that a trans woman can stand on a TED platform wearing a red carpet gown and giving a competition to any other female who is there in the showbiz. So that's all for today. I hope that there are 100 people who are sitting here, that please go and talk about that community to other your family members. Please tell them to behave like with us, not in a biased form. Give us opportunities. We're not asking for sympathy. We're asking for opportunities. And once we get opportunities, we will prove ourselves. Thank you so much.